Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Lord, thank you for all the pleasantries that we are afforded here in this wonderful church. Things like an air-conditioned building on a hot day and lights and video and music and all the wonderful things that we get. Lord, we don't come into this house, though, for those things. We don't come to church for entertainment. We don't come to church to fulfill a ritual or a tradition. We don't come into this house to hear from a man or from a woman, from the old or from the young. Lord, we come into this place to hear from you, and we acknowledge that at the Rock, it's Jesus that's the senior leader of this house. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that you would speak to us, that your Holy Spirit would minister to us, to lead us and to guide us and to counsel us and remind us of your word, Lord. I pray that you would direct us and motivate us into your words, Father, that we would learn to live and operate and continue to go in your will and your desire for our lives. And, Father, as we do, we thank you that you have blessed us in this house. These blessings that we ask upon ourselves daily, we don't ask just upon this church, but upon all the churches across the Inland Empire, Lord, because we are fully aware that we cannot reach this Inland Empire all by ourselves. There are too many people and too few of us to do the job. So, Father, we thank you that you have placed us here with brothers and sisters all around this Inland Empire under various denominational names and other various names. But, Lord, we thank you that all the other churches in the Inland Empire that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ, we see them as our brothers and sisters as we work together to build your kingdom, Lord, for your glory. So, God, we ask that you would bless them as you have blessed us. Bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and all the churches that belong to the various denominations that proclaim Jesus as the Lord. Father, we thank you for local churches like Harvest and The Grove. Father, we thank you for Sandals and Water of Life, Abundant Living. Father, we thank you for Ecclesia and Emmanuel Baptist and Victory and Trinity and Lord, Crossroads. All the churches, we ask that you would bless them as you have blessed us. Father, we thank you that we're all many members of the body of Christ working together to build your kingdom. So, Lord, to you be the praise, and to you be the glory, and to you be the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Amen. Well, if you've got your Bibles, go with me again to the book of Hebrews, chapter 11. We're going to continue our study in the Hebrews, chapter 11, line upon line, precept upon precept. And I tell you what, it's a real exciting time. We're going to be concluding a section of Scripture that we've been in since the month of July. Now, we took a break in the months of May and of June to start a series called The Blessed Life and to see God's design and his purpose for us to live a blessed life and what that means for you and I. And then in the month of July, we resumed our studies in the book of Hebrews, looking at the life of this man, Abraham. And literally over these 2.5 months, we have talked from verse number 8 of chapter 11 all the way now to verse number 12 of chapter 11. And we're going to conclude this week this portion of Scripture of Abraham's life. Lots of great things that we've learned out of that, and talking about the rest of the paradox of faith and waiting on God and stepping out in faith and so forth and so on. Lots of wonderful things. But if you got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Hebrews in the 11th chapter. Hebrews, the 11th chapter. Today we're going to look at verse number 12. Verse number 12, talking about Abraham, says, "Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born as many as the stars of the sky, and the multitude, innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore." Talking about the life of Abraham today, the Bible uses a really amazing statement, a really descriptive phrase here for Abraham in his life, a man who was as good as dead. You ever heard that phrase before, as good as dead? Meaning even though something has not physically died, in their heart, in somebody's mind, in somebody's design, that thing has died, has ceased to exist. And Abraham, in his life, in the period of where he's at, the Bible says a man who was as good as dead, 90-something years old here in this point of his life, from this one man came as many descendants as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. Today I want to talk to you about the subject of life and death. Because you see, we all face life and death in our lives. And today specifically I want to look at the subject of death, or things dying to us. Not death in our own mortal lives or the death of a loved one, so forth and so on. But I want to talk about the representation of death in our lives. Death of our hopes. Death of our dreams, death of the things that we had once thought we would achieve and so forth and so on. We all face these situations in which something becomes as good as dead to us. Maybe you had a dream when you were a child, a dream to be something or to be someone, to follow a particular career or to have a family or whatever it might be. And as the years progressed through your life, that dream never came to pass. And you can look back on that dream and say, that dream to me is as good as dead. Maybe God spoke to you and you were operating and waiting on the Lord and stepping out in faith in a business venture or something of that fashion. You've been waiting on God and you've been waiting on God and you've been waiting on God and you've been waiting even longer, and it seems to you that, you know, this vision, this calling, this stepping out in faith has become as good as dead to me. Maybe there's an emotion in your life. Maybe you were happy at one point and then you had some circumstances, some things that happened to you, some people said some things to you, or you were wounded by somebody very close to you, and you begin to say about your emotions, about your happiness, you know, that area of my life is as good as dead. I'll never love again, or I'll never be happy again because of this or because of that. Maybe you're in a season where you have a relationship, a spouse or a family member, a son or a daughter, or a distant relative, and which you crossed words at some point in your life and communication has ceased, or you've had to make hard or difficult decisions, and you think to yourself in that time and that relationship that this relationship is as good as dead to me now. And I see that things are just going to be the way they are, and I just want to live out the rest of my days as I can and as much peace and as much happiness as I can. But you see, God's desire for us is to not live out the rest of our days with the mentality that we are as good as dead. That a relationship that was severed, or that an issue that's in our life, that we leave it as good as dead. But rather, God has something for us. But what happens is, as we wait, as we continue to progress through life, as each day passes us by, hope begins to wane, to fade, to dissolve. And it becomes as good as dead to us as we're waiting and waiting and waiting and wondering, God, where are you in my life? God, where are you in my relationship? God, where are you in my dreams? God, where are you in my visions? God, where are you in the passions of my life? Because I'm waiting and I'm waiting and I'm waiting, and it seems like you're not there. And so what happens to us is we grapple a hold of whatever we can to hold on to something that we can see is slipping through our fingers, slipping away into a death, so to say, of our hearts. I remember in a real shallow and different type of illustration, I have this particular pair of socks. I'm a real particular about my socks. Not quite so much like Pastor Dan, who wears the funky socks, but I just, if my sock doesn't fit right, I have to have a certain type of sock. And when it comes to athletic type abilities, or things like hiking or walking or anything like that, I have a specific brand of sock, a specific type of sock, and it has to fit exactly the right way. And these particular socks were wool. And I remember one day I was at work here and I was working, and I looked down and I saw my sock somehow. I was sitting in my chair and maybe I had my leg crossed over. I don't remember the particulars of it, but I got a glimpse of this sock, one of my favorite socks. And you're not supposed to wear big, thick, sport-type socks with dress shoes, but I've always done that because I'm particular about my socks. And there was a string sticking out of my sock. Have you ever seen that before? I thought, well, that string's driving me nuts. So what did I do? I started pulling on that string. And all of a sudden, that string kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger. My sock just kept unwinding. And I'm like, this is my favorite sock, you know. So I go and I get the scissors and I cut the string off, and hoping that cutting the string off would stop it from unraveling, but the damage had already been done and the sock was beginning to unravel. So as the day progressed, what I did, I thought it was a really good idea, is I went and got some scotch tape, you know, that clear tape, and just try to tape my sock to keep it from unraveling, hoping and to do whatever I could to keep my sock from falling apart. Sure enough, as I got home, I threw it in the laundry pile as I normally do. And when it came out of the dryer, guess what happened to my sock? It was as good as dead. Sometimes that happens to us in life. Something begins to unravel, whatever it is. A circumstance, something somebody said over you, a relationship, a hard time, whatever it might be, something begins the process of unraveling that dream that you had as a child, or that hope that you were holding on to. Something began to unravel that relationship that meant so much to you, and now all of a sudden it is beginning to fade away. And no matter how hard we try, no matter how tight we grab a hold of things, it seems like no matter what we do on our own, we can never stop it from doing what it seems like it's going to do, and that's to unravel away from us and become as good as dead. We hold on for dear life to these things, and as a matter of fact, Abraham is an example of this very story. A man 90 years old, given by God a promise to have an inheritance. You see, in Abraham's time, they started having children a lot younger than we do in our society, in our day and age. And a man who was Abraham's age, having the promise of an inheritance through an heir, Abraham should have already seen alive 6 generations of his lineage. Not only at this age of his life, at this point of his life, should he have already had a son, But he should have had a grandson and a great-grandson and a great-great-grandson and even a great-great-great-grandson. But yet here's a man, 90 years old in his life, going throughout the course of his life wondering, God, when is your promise going to come to pass in my life? I'm not getting any younger. The days aren't going by any faster. Everything is happening and nothing of what you said is coming to pass. An idea, an example of hope beginning to fade. How is hope beginning to fade? Because Abraham begins to look at his wife Sarah and say, well, maybe you aren't the answer of God's promise in my life. As Sarah offers up her maidservant, Hagar, and Abraham has a son, Ishmael. God says, that is not my plan. My promise was not for just you. It's for you and your wife, Sarah. I've got a plan for you. But hope began to fade away. Became as good as dead. Worthless. She couldn't have children. So what do we do when these things happen to us? When our dreams, our visions, our hopes, our desires, our relationships, our emotional stability, our happiness, the ventures of things that we've stepped out of in faith to God. What happens when these things begin to unravel in our lives and it seems like they are dying to us? What can we do? Well, the Bible has a lot to say about lost hope, about things that become dead to us in our hearts and what we can do about that. I want to take you to a story. In the book of John in the 11th chapter, a story that's very familiar to you, and I use it oftentimes. It's probably one of my more favorite stories in the Bible, the story of Lazarus. And I want to look through the story of Lazarus and to see what you and I can pull out of this story today in the subject of lost hopes, of death in our lives, death to our dreams, to our visions, to our desires, to our hopes, to the relationships that we are holding on to for dear life, and what the Bible says about that to you and I. So in John, the 11th chapter, the Bible begins to tell us that there was a man by the name of Lazarus who grew sick. Now, Lazarus was the brother of two women, Martha and Mary. Now, you've heard the story, or you may have heard their names in the Bible before. Jesus was at dinner at their house, and Mary was seated at the feet of Jesus, listening to Jesus speak. But Martha, her sister, was busy in the kitchen, cooking the dinner and preparing the meal and everything else like that. And Martha was upset at Mary because she wanted Mary to help. But Jesus said to Martha, Martha, Mary knows what is important. I am only here for a short while to teach us the lesson, to not get so wrapped up in the busyness of life that we miss out on the messages of Jesus and we miss out on the quality time that God so desires for us. And so the Bible tells us that Jesus had an affinity for these sisters and for this family. He had a deep affection for them. And so here in John, the 11th chapter, Jesus is summoned on behalf of Lazarus because Lazarus has become sick and very ill. And they say to Jesus, Jesus, come. We're just a couple of miles away from where you're at. Please come on behalf of Lazarus because he has become very ill. And the Bible tells us in John, the 11th chapter, in verse number 4, the Bible says that Jesus, when he hears this, the summons to come to Lazarus, Jesus says, the sickness is not unto death, but unto the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now put yourself for a moment in that messenger's shoes. Put yourself in the moment of the disciples' shoes and all those around who just heard what Jesus said. Jesus, come, Lazarus is sick, we need you to come right now. And Jesus' response to the call is, he won't die. This sickness is not unto death. So what do we think? We think, well, Jesus just said Lazarus is gonna be just fine. That everything's going to be okay, that he's sick, but it's not going to kill him. So this is all going to be good. You'll see this is a lesson here is what Jesus is saying. So the time progresses on. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us in John, the 11th chapter, that Jesus stays two more days in the town in which he's at, just a couple of miles away. After a couple of days, Jesus says, well, we need to go over to Lazarus. The disciples say, Jesus, if we travel right now, like we want to leave right now, like it's like late, it's getting late, we should wait. And Jesus says, man, we got to go right now. It's time to go. He said, Jesus, they tried to stone you. They tried to kill you when you left last time. And Jesus says, it's time to go. And the Bible tells us that Jesus says these words about Lazarus. He says, Lazarus, our friend, is sleeping. And I'm going to go that I might wake him up. Okay, once again, putting yourself into the disciples' position, into the messenger's position. Jesus, Lazarus is sick. We need you. Come quickly. And Jesus responds, the sickness is not unto death. So we perceive that to us as Jesus says it's going to be okay. And then 2 days later, Jesus says to his disciples, Lazarus is sleeping. I need to go wake him up. So what do the disciples do? Thinking only what they would logically think at the time, they say, Jesus, if Lazarus is sleeping, shouldn't we let him sleep? Because rest is good for the body, and if Lazarus is resting, he'll get better. But Jesus replies back to them plainly, because they didn't understand what Jesus was saying. He says to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. Jesus had waited 2 days to respond to his call. 2 days of sitting in the town waiting on this. Lazarus is going to be okay. Lazarus is sleeping. Lazarus is dead. This is a hopeless situation. A time in which hope, a time in which emotions have now become as good as dead. When reliance has become as good as dead. Why? Because now the story just got real. Lazarus died. So the Bible says that Thomas, one of the disciples, says, well, let us go and that we may die with him. You know, I think Thomas was a real, you know, go-getter sometimes. He gets a bad rap. He had a better life than we see in just the Gospels. But they get up and they go to the city. And there, as they're coming into the city of Bethany where Lazarus lived, Martha, Lazarus' sister, runs to Jesus and she meets Jesus. She says this amazing statement to Jesus. She says, Jesus, if you were here, Lazarus wouldn't have died. Where were you? We asked for you to come. The messenger came back and said that you said that this sickness wasn't unto death. But he's dead. He's gone. If you would have just been here, Jesus, my brother would not be dead. Sometimes in our lives, when it comes to your dreams, when it comes to your visions, when it comes to your hopes, when it comes to the plans that you have for your lives, when it comes to the relationships, things that have happened to you, sometimes in our lives it seems, God, if you would have only been there at that moment, I wouldn't be where I'm at today. My relationship wouldn't have been what it is today. My dreams wouldn't be what they are today. My life would not have been what it is today if you would have just shown up in the moment that I needed you. And Jesus says to Mary, excuse me, to Martha, he says, you will see your brother again. And she says, well, Jesus, I know I'll see him in the resurrection. I know that there'll be a time when everybody comes up. And you know how we say it in funerals nowadays? There's somebody, they stand up there and they say, you know, I know that this isn't goodbye. It's just see you later. She says, I get what you're saying, Jesus. And I know it's not a goodbye. I know it's just a see you later. And he begins to tell, he says, no. If you believe, you'll see the glory of God. Something's going to happen. So Mary or Martha goes and she secretly takes her sister and gives her sister and she says, Jesus is here. And Mary, who was the one that was seated at Jesus' feet, listening and taking in Jesus' words, she was so upset, so hurt by the situation that when Jesus came to town, she didn't even come. But Martha secretly went and got her. And so here comes Mary to Jesus. And interestingly enough, Mary says the same thing. Jesus, if you would have just been here, my brother would be alive today. Jesus, if you would have just showed up like we asked you to, if you would have just responded to our request, if you would have just come when we had asked, Lazarus would have been alive today. But now he's gone. He's in the grave. It's been some time. And Jesus says to her, if you believe, you'll see the glory of God. If you believe. So people around Mary and Martha, they begin to say, isn't this the one that heals the deaf and the blind? Could he have not kept Lazarus from dying? Why did he not stop this from happening? Sometimes in our lives, it seems like God shows up a little bit too late. That he wasn't there when we needed him. Jesus, where were you when I cried out to you? When my relationship was falling apart? It would have been a lot easier if everything would have been dealt with then instead of now. And here I am today, and the situation, this area of my life seems like it's as good as dead. But Jesus says something. Did I not say that if you believe, you would see the glory of God? You know, sometimes I don't want to see the glory of God. I just want to see my life get fixed. Sometimes I don't want to come to church and get the goosebumps and hear the pastor preach an amazing message. I just want to feel better. Sometimes I don't want to see the life lesson in the message. I just want my brother back. But Jesus says, if you believe, you'll see the glory of God. And it goes on in verse number 41. The next verse is, he says, they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was laying, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and he began to pray. And he said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. He goes on in the second verse and he says, and I know that you always hear me, but because of the people are standing by, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me. So here's Jesus saying these statements. He says, here I am. Lazarus is dead, he tells his disciples, and I'm glad he's dead. What kind of insensitive statement would somebody say to that? I'm glad Lazarus is dead. And now here he is in front of everybody, and he's beginning to pray, and he says, God, I'm glad that you hear me. I know that you always hear me. As a matter of fact, I am praying today right now because there are people standing around who need you, need me to talk to you, and you need to know that I am talking to you. So then all of a sudden something happens in verse number 43. After he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus, come forth. Look what it says in verse number 44. He who had died came out. He who had died came out. Lazarus was dead. And yet he came out of that grave, bound in burial clothes on his face and on his hands. And Jesus says, loose him and let him go. Sometimes it seems like that dream is dead. Sometimes it seems like that vision or that hope is gone. Seems like that relationship is hopeless and there's no more hope or no more emotion left to give. And so it's as good as dead. But Jesus, when he speaks, something happens. And he says to Lazarus, come forth. And he who was dead came out. What we can take from the story of Lazarus, what we can learn from this message that we grab a hold of, is there are areas of our lives that become dead to us. Emotions and feelings and dreams and relationships and hopes and business ventures and so forth and so on. Because we wait and we wait and we wait and we wait. And the longer we wait, it seems like the lower and the lower and the lower our hope grows. But we can learn something about this message, about the story. And that is Jesus makes that which is good as dead live again. Jesus makes that which is as good as dead live again. That relationship that you've been believing in God for restoration, that's dead to you or somebody else. Jesus makes that which is as good as dead live again. That dream that you once had, but life got in the way, it's dead to you, no hope anymore. Jesus makes that which is as good as dead live again. That emotion, that happiness, that fulfillment in your life that you once had, but then life got in the way, Jesus takes that and makes that which is as good as dead live again. Perhaps it's best exemplified by Jesus in his own life. 3 days in the grave. Nailed to the cross, and Joseph of Arimathea puts him in his own grave. They bind him up and they anoint his body and they put him in a stone, and the disciples look at each other and they say, what do we do now? What did we just spend the last 3 years of our lives doing? What do we do? And they go back to doing what they knew what to do, to go fish. And yet, 3 days later, through no power but the power of God, Jesus was resurrected from the grave. Because Jesus makes that which was as good as dead live again. He did it to us in our salvation. The Bible says that we were dead in our trespasses, separated from God, but yet through Christ have been made to live. We are now given a royal position. Why? Because Jesus takes and he makes that which is as good as dead, church, and he gives it life again. Your life, your dreams, your happiness, your fulfillment, the relationships that you are standing on, God. He takes that which is as good as dead and he makes it live again. We just have to learn to put it into God's hands, which is one of the hardest, easy things to do. to give it to God. It's so easy, give it to God, but it's so hard. So what do we do? Yeah, amen, hallelujah. Jesus makes that which is as good as dead live again, but when I look at myself in the mirror tomorrow, I still feel dead. That relationship, somebody still doesn't answer. They don't respond. My dreams, my visions, the call for my job didn't come through. So then what? What do I do? It's the hardest, easy thing to do ever. When it seems like all is lost, give it to God and watch what He does with it. When it seems like all is lost, give it to God, to Jesus, and watch what He does with it. Watch it. You see, we try to grapple. We try to hold on. We want to say, I want to give it to you, God, but then I want to hold on to it. No, give it to God and watch what He does with it. Watch it. Let it go. Give it to Him. Put it in His hands. You see, Abraham was as good as dead. But because it was as good as dead to Abraham didn't mean it was dead to God. Just because it's as good as dead to you doesn't mean that it's dead to God. Look what it says in Hebrews, back in our subject scripture today, Hebrews 11 chapter. I'll just put it up on the overheads for you because we'll stay in John. Hebrews 11 chapter verse number 12, it says, therefore. If you've been at this church for any given time, you know that therefore is a very important word in the Bible. Because of what I just said, therefore a reason it's there. Therefore, from one man, Abraham, who is as good as dead. Therefore, what? Verse number 8, Abraham obeyed. Therefore, what? Verse number 9, Abraham followed and he dwelt God. Therefore, what? Verse number 10, Abraham waited on God. Therefore, what? Verse number 11, Sarah trusted and counted God faithful. Because Abraham obeyed, because he followed, because he waited, and because they trusted God, because of all of that, from one man who was as good as dead came the lineage as many as the stars in the sky and the sands on the seashore. Why? Because Abraham tried to do things on his own and it didn't work. But God said, that's not what I have for you. Abraham, your dream is as good as dead. But then, when Sarah couldn't have a baby like mom said, that's when she could have the baby. Because they had to give it to God and just watch. God, I'm too old. God, I can't do this. God, I'm too tired. But then something happened. From one man who was as good as dead came as many as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. Your dreams, your visions, your hopes, your aspirations, the things that you held on to, the excitement that you had when you first came to Jesus, although it seems like it might be as good as dead, if it's dead to you, it doesn't mean it's dead to God. It's not dead to God. Give it to Jesus and watch what He does with it. When it seems like all is lost, give it to God and watch what He does with it. In John the 11th chapter, there's some things I wanted to pull out that we can understand about this and how and understanding. I think if we can understand how something works and why something works, it's easier for us to apply that to our lives. And so here in John the 11th chapter, when Jesus gets the summons, He says, this isn't unto death, but for the glory of God. And then verse number 11, He says that Lazarus is sleeping. I go that I might wake him up. The question I ask is, did he miss it? Did he get the wrong information? I mean, was Jesus wrong and he was just misunderstood? Did he not hear from God? And maybe he just spoke in what he thought he had heard? Because he says Lazarus sleeps. But at this time, Lazarus was already in the grave, dead, beginning to decompose. So did Jesus miss it? Because sometimes in life, it seems like, God, I needed you in this moment, and you didn't show up. God, I cried out to you in this moment, and I didn't hear back. Did you miss it? Did you not hear? Were you busy with somebody else? What was going on? But you see, the truth in this matter is that Jesus didn't miss it at all. He saw it from a different perspective. See, the world in Bethany knew that Lazarus was dead, but Jesus knew that Lazarus was only sleeping, resting, So what we can learn from this story is that death is not the end to God.
Amen.
Death is not the end.
Amen.
We know this in our own lives, that when we die, Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. We know that our own physical, mortal death is not the end of our existence. Church, the end of the death of your hope, the death of your dreams, the death of a relationship, the death of a business venture, the death of your faith stepping out is not the end to God. Why? Because Jesus said, Lazarus sleeps, but Lazarus was dead to us. Death is not the end. Going on in the story as Jesus goes and he begins and they roll the tomb away and Jesus is about to go to Lazarus. Martha says to Jesus, verse number 39, Lord, by this time, there's a stench, for he has been dead 4 days. 4 days. She's rubbing it in. You see, culture and beliefs at the time in that early, that first century there, is they believed that the body, when it would die, the spirit of the body would hover, would stay over the body for 3 days. After the third day, the body, the spirit would go. And so Martha is saying to Jesus, Jesus, it's been 4 days. You're a day late and a dollar short. Even so much so to say, Jesus, it's so late that the natural decomposition of his body has already begun to take place, and now there's a stench coming from his grave. It's dead. It's over. It's hopeless. But we know the story. Jesus says, Lazarus, come forth. And he who was dead came out. You see, what we can learn from is that it's never too late for God to work. It's never too late for God to work. Some of you are in this place and you're young and you've made some dumb choices in your life. And you look at the future and you say, I have ruined my life. I have gone down the wrong path. I have too many consequences to go in my life. But let me tell you something. It is never too late for God to work. Some of you are in this place, and you have lived a long life. Your years are beginning to sunset, and you look toward the end of your life, and you say, I just want to live out the rest of my days and what little peace and what little happiness I can acquire for myself. Let me tell you something. Your life is not done yet. It is never too late for God to work. We are never too far gone for God to work in our lives. If he can do it for Jesus in the grave in 3 days, if he can do it for Lazarus in the grave after 4 days, he can do it for you. He can do it for me. It's never too late for God to work. Church, when it seems like all is lost, give it to God and watch what he does with it. Those desires of your heart that seem like they're died, those hopes and that optimism that you once had, and it seems like it's dying, that relationship that's falling apart, that connection that pulls your heart out every time you see something happening, give it to God. And watch what happens. Why can you do that? Because Jesus makes that which is as good as dead live again.
Yes,
today, church, this room is full of people whose stories aren't yet finished. God's not done with you yet. He's not finished with you yet. In the story of your life, in the story of your dreams, in the story of your emotions, in the story of your fulfillment, it does not yet say about you the end. When it seems like all is lost, give it to God and watch what he does with it. If anything else today, maybe you walked into this place and you felt like you were on your last rope, hanging on for dear life. Something happened to you this week, this month, this year, and you haven't been able to shake it. If anything, then today, church, remember this. Hold on. Hold on. Just hold on. Keep going. Keep going. Far too many people get to the position that Mary was in when Jesus comes to town. I don't even want to go out to see him anymore. because he didn't show up when I wanted him at the moment. But Jesus comes with a whole new perspective. Because it's dead to you doesn't mean it's dead to God. Hold on. Keep going. Keep going. There was a young man in the 1800s and he went to the Black Hawk War, a captain. Aspirations to make something for his life. To be somebody in the world. To make a difference in the world around him. And through no fault of his own, when he returned from that war, he came back a private, demoted from his position. He got into a job, started his profession as a lawyer. People said that his career would be unsuccessful. Why? Because he was far too impractical to be a lawyer in the area in which he did. He ran to be a congressman, and he was defeated for Congress. He tried to become the officer of land management for the United States, and he was defeated in that election. He ran for Senate, and he was defeated in that election. He ran again for Congress, and he was defeated in that election. He ran again for state Senate, hoping to do something with his life, and yet again was defeated in that election. But yet 30 years after the dream of becoming somebody and something, Abraham Lincoln was elected the President of the United States. And on that fateful day, gave his Emancipation Proclamation. And he helped to guide this great nation through its darkest season in history. But he didn't give up. He didn't stop when he was defeated, when he was demoted, when his business didn't take off the way he wanted to. He kept on going. Church, keep going. Keep going. Hold on to what God has spoken to you. Just because it's dead to you doesn't mean it's dead to God. Amen. It may seem hopeless, but death is not the end. It may seem like there's no chance, but it's never too late for God to work in your life. When it seems like all is lost, give it to God and watch what he does with it. Why? Because Jesus makes that which was as good as dead come to life. Hebrews 10:23 says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. Why? For he who promised is faithful. God's got a plan for you. God's got a will for you. He's got a direction for you. Hold on. Keep going. Because Jesus takes and makes that which was as good as dead come to life. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Amen. Hey, listen, before we leave, I wanted to do just one thing real quick, and I'll let you guys out. We'll get out a little early today, and that's good. You see, I don't know everybody in this place, and so it would be a travesty, it would be a shame for me to leave and dismiss under the pretenses that every person in this room is right and in the right position with God. When in the truth is that there are those of you in this place that you walked into this place and you know, if you looked into your heart and you examined, you would realize and come to the conclusion that you are missing out on your relationship with God. And so the Bible says that a man ought to examine himself from time to time. So first I'll ask, give me a moment of your attention. Don't get up and don't leave. Just listen to what I have to say because it's so important. I want to ask you to do something with me. I want you to examine your heart. As Paul the Apostle encourages us to examine our hearts and to examine our lives, to ask yourself this question. I know it's a difficult question. It's a hypothetical question because I pray it doesn't happen. But if you were to leave today and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? It's a real simple question. But you see, how you answer that question has a lot to say about your position and your standing with God and how you draw about your conclusions. So let's talk about that. You know, oftentimes we have a hard time to believe, well, you know, if God is a loving God, I have a hard time believing in a loving God that would send men to hell. Can I tell you something? God's not in the business of condemning men to hell. As a matter of fact, God's in the business of redeeming men to heaven. Hell wasn't created for you and I. It wasn't designed for us. There aren't any parties there. Whether we believe or it exists or it doesn't make it go away. You see, heaven's a real place. Hell is a real place. But you see, God's desire and his design and his intent for you and I was to spend an eternity with him in paradise, not in hell. But it's a choice that we all have to make. So when we look at ourselves and we examine, you know, nowhere in the Bible does it say that when you ask yourself that question, you come about the conclusion, man, I hope I'm going to go to heaven. I want to go to heaven. I wish that I go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can hope your way into heaven? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can want or wish or desire your way into heaven like God's some kind of a genie. If you wish it hard enough, you'll get it. You can't get to heaven because you hope so. Yet so many people, when I ask them that question, respond with that answer, I hope so. Wouldn't it be better to have a system or a way to know more than just a I hope so, but rather to know? Today I want to offer that to you. You see, nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself a title, because you've professed yourself to be a Christian, a word that only shows up in the Bible in the New Testament 2 times. Yet we think if I give myself a label, if I wear a cross around my neck or I have a tattoo on my body that has a scripture reference, that all I have to do all of a sudden is I'm good with God. The census, when they came knocking on my door, asked me, and I told them that I was a Christian and Christians go to heaven. I wasn't a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or anything else, so I always thought that meant by default that meant I was a Christian. Did you know that nowhere in God's word does it say that because you give yourself a label, that you call yourself a Christian, because you wear a cross around your neck or because of a system of classification, that you're going to get to heaven? You won't find that in God's word. Can't get to heaven that way. Well, but I was baptized as a baby. I was christened. They christened me as a child. I went to Sunday school or Sabbath school classes or catechism classes growing up. My parents dragged me to church all the time in Christmas and on Easter. I'm here all the time. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you were christened or baptized as a baby, that because you went to catechism or Sunday school classes? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents took you to church on Christmas and on Easter? Nowhere does it say that because you attend church on a regular basis that you're going to get to heaven. You can't find that in God's word. Why? Because it doesn't exist. Can't get to heaven because you attend church on a regular basis. We think, well, if I volunteer, I'm involved, I got a card in my wallet that says I'm a member of a church. Church members go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that? You can't find that in the word of God. So often what happens is we think, well, I'm a good person. If I do good things, I try to give to the Red Cross and help out my fellow human being. I try to do more good in my life than I do bad. I try to think positively about things. Good people go to heaven. But did you know that nowhere in God's word does it say that? As a matter of fact, God's word tells us that our good deeds, according to God's righteousness, are like filthy rags. You see, nothing you and I could ever do on our own would ever make us good enough to get into heaven. Why? Because the Bible says this about us. We have all of us, sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But you know what? That doesn't have to be the end. That doesn't have to be the result. That doesn't have to be where we land, because there's something more that God has a desire for you. His desire is a connection with you, a relationship with you. You see, we can't get to heaven your way or my way or some well-meaning author's way. The only way we can get to heaven is God's way. Why? Because it's God's heaven. And God's standard is perfection, but we've messed up. We've sinned. We've fallen short of that glory, each and every one of us. But it doesn't have to be the result, the end result. Why? Because Jesus is our answer. Jesus says that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through him. See, we can't get to heaven any other way but God's way, and that's his son, Jesus Christ. In John, the 3rd chapter, Jesus says to a religious man, a man who did all the right things, said all the right things, memorized scripture, did all, helped the people around him, a good man. Jesus says to Nicodemus, in order to see the kingdom of God, you must be born again. There it is, God's way. What does that mean? Well, it's not what Hollywood and society and culture has made it out to be. Born again, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, has always meant the same thing in the eyes and in the heart of God. Here it is, you ready? It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his son, Jesus Christ. It's a relationship, a flourishing and growing relationship with Jesus. A relationship of life for you today. And I want to give you the opportunity to accept that, to receive that relationship. It's not about your mental ascent. You can scarcely go anywhere in America and find somebody who doesn't know who Jesus is. But did you know the Bible tells us that the devil in hell and the demons in hell know and believe that Jesus is the Son of God? Yet they're not going to get to heaven because of that. It's more than just your mental ascent and your carnal knowledge about knowing who Jesus is. It's like saying, I know who the President of the United States is, but I don't know him personally. It's a very different thing. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. Jesus says this in the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible. It's his final plea to you and I, the people of the church. And he says, listen, I'll paraphrase what he says. He says, you think that you're rich. You think that you're clothed in splendor. You think that you have it all together. He says, but you don't realize that you're naked and that you're destitute. He says, oh, I wish that you would come to me. Stop doing life your way. You've tried long enough and it's not working out for you. Today, he says, I wish that you would come to me. And he goes on and he says, I wish that I find that you're hot or cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. And it's a shocking statement, yes, out of the mouth of Jesus. And it's his final plea to say, church, stop doing life your way. He says, I'd rather find you all one or all the other. Because if you are lukewarm, what does that mean, lukewarm? Simply means in your relationship that you got your ups and your downs. Your ins and your outs, occasional church attendance, doing some of your own thing. Listen, you're doing the church thing, the church lingo, the church attitude on Sunday, but Monday when you're back at work or with your friends, you're doing what they're doing and doing what the world's doing, riding the fence. Come on, that's an uncomfortable position to be in. And I love you enough and I respect you enough and I honor you enough today to tell you the truth. Even if it offends you or hurts you, you're not going to make it that way. But that doesn't have to be the end. Because you see, the Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. And like any gift, it's an option. We have a free will choice to accept it or to reject it. It's your call. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way in. Oftentimes people believe, well, if God wants me, he'll just take me. But listen, God did everything he could by giving Jesus to die on a cross for you and for me. And in return, he wants all of our hearts and all of our lives. But he's given us the choice to evaluate, to examine what we hear, and to accept it as truth. And today I want to give you that opportunity. Jesus said these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. He says, if you deny him, he'll deny you. The decision is totally and wholly yours. Today I want to give you that opportunity. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And when I smack my hands together, I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're making a decision. You're saying, I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. I want to make sure today. I don't want to just walk around with a vague hope or a wish. I want to know for sure my position with God. I've been doing life my way, and I want to get God in my life today. That life that we were talking about. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand, and I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Say, man, if I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed, Pastor Luke. Somebody's going to see me. Listen, I'm not going to embarrass you, but even if you were embarrassed, wouldn't it be better for a moment to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell? Why? Because let me challenge you. If you can't go forward for God in a warm and welcome and loving place like a church who supports you, believes you, and wants you to make this decision, what makes you think outside of the walls of this building that you'll follow? It starts today by making that decision. The Bible says it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. It's the Spirit of God speaking to you. No one can come to the Father, Jesus says, unless he's drawn. Speaking to you right now. Who should raise your hands if you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus? If that's you in just a moment, when I count to three, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. Who should raise their hands today? Who should give their heart, their life to Jesus? Maybe you did this as a child. Maybe you did this in your youth group. Or maybe you went to a Harvest Crusade with Greg Glory and you prayed that prayer with him once before, but you've never really followed through afterwards. You say, man, I just don't know. I'm not sure. Nothing really made it. Nothing really happened in my life. Listen, if you're not sure, don't walk out of this place without being sure. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, been doing a little bit of church, a little bit of world, a little bit of outside, a little bit of inside, riding the fence, listen, that's a terrible place to be in. You know it. Life of turmoil. It's time for you to accept life today and accept your eternal destiny with Jesus. It's not even so much what happens when you die. That's so important to you and I, but you know what? Jesus says that I have come. He says, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. You see, Jesus wants you to have life on the inside of you today, not just when you die. Jesus makes that which was as good as dead. Maybe your life, you felt like it was as good as dead, worthless, good for nothing. It's time for you to start to see the value that God sees in your eyes and in your life by accepting life in Jesus Christ today. All across this auditorium, from side to side, from the front row to the back row, even you guys in the family rooms, I can see you. I can see you right there through the windows. If you're at home watching on the live stream or you're on the campus watching through closed circuit television, wherever you're at, listen, this is your moment. This is your time. Give you that opportunity. When I count to three, if that's you, pop your hand up. You'll see it. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. And we'll go forward together from there right afterwards, changing destinies forever today. But it starts by making that decision. You've had doctors and dentist appointments. Now it's a divine appointment. You're here today for this reason. And it's time for you to respond. So when I count to three, if that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. I'll see it. And we'll go forward together from there. Wherever you're at in this place, doesn't matter if you've been in this church for 27 years or you've been in this church for 1 hour. Today is the day of your salvation. It's time for you to respond. You ready? I'm going to count to three. When I do, that's your moment. Ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. I see my man standing up. Seven. I see you right over there. Eight. I got you right over there. Eight wise people. I got you, my man, over here. Eight wise people over on this section. I got you right up here in the front in the red. Nine. I see you back there in the back. Ten. I see you back over there. 11. I see you over there. 12. I see you over there. All right. 13. I see you right there. Anybody else in this place, you say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes, you should. This is your moment. This is your time. Spirit of God speaking to you. Hey, don't resist it. Don't reject it. It's time for you to accept life and see what God does with the rest of your life. It starts today by making that decision. Anybody else today? 13 so wise people. Anybody else today? I'm going to go forward from this. We'll close it up. We'll conclude right now. Let's praise God for 13 or so wise people. Hallelujah. Here's what we're going to do for all 13 of you. Maybe you're number 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, whatever. That you didn't raise your hand, but you're thinking, man, I should have done that. It's not too late. Remember, I said this. You're making a decision to follow Jesus. A decision. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by taking action on a decision. Any decision without action is nothing. So you made that decision. Now it's time to act upon your decision. We're going to do that together. We're going to change destinies in just a moment together. And here's what I'm going to ask for those of you that raised your hand, or maybe you didn't, but you should have raised your hand. When we all stand in a moment, I'm going to invite everybody to stand. I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you came with somebody or somebody brought you, look to them and say, hey, come on, will you go with me? Or you saw somebody raise their hand and say, come on, you know what? I'll go with you. I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle and come meet me right here at this altar. We're going to change destinies together. Your life is forever going to be changed, but it starts by taking action on the decision that you've made today, and we're going to do that together. So let's all stand together, and as we do, please nobody leave as they come forward, but if you raised your hand or you didn't raise your hand, but you should have, this is your moment, this is your time. Come on, get out of your seat, come meet me up here today. Let's change destinies right now. Come on, you can come. This is your moment. They're still coming. Come on, we'll wait for you. You're worth waiting for. This is your moment. Come on. Come change destinies today. Well, hey, praise God. You guys made this. You here. Congratulations. Listen, you know what? Maybe you've made a lifetime of mistakes. Maybe you've been a mess up all your life. I don't know. But I want to tell you something. Maybe nobody's ever told you before in your life, but somebody needs to tell you. Good job. Good job. Hey, good job. You know why? Because today is the first day of the rest of your life. You're not going to the morgue. You're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. Why? You're going to get born again. As you come, well, come on, we'll wait for you, my man. You can just listen while we're talking. You're going to get born again. Good job. Congratulations. Here's what I want to do. I'm going to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? He's looking real cool. His name is Pastor Joel, like Noel for Christmas. Joel, really cool guy. Love this guy to death. Really neat guy. Here's what he's going to do. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on, I promise, okay? You don't get saved because you raise your hand. You get saved by inviting Jesus Christ to come into your life, to be the Lord and Savior of your life. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? We don't talk like that anymore. How about this? To be the leader of your life. You're inviting him into your life, and you're going to do that with a prayer, okay? Secondly, we don't want you to leave empty-handed. We want to get you information. We want to get you set on the right foot so that when you walk out of this place and you say, what do I do next? We're going to help point you in the right direction. So we're going to give you some free information, some real easy reading. When you go home, you can just read it over to help get you started on the right track of your new decision. And the third thing he's going to do, the greatest thing, or I think that one of the greatest things he's going to do, is he's going to introduce to you today a friend here in church. You'll know somebody. You don't have to come and say, well, I don't know anybody here. You'll know somebody today, a friend, somebody that will meet with you right before church or right after church. So buy a cup of coffee or get you a soda from our Love Rock Cafe, get you a steak dinner, whatever we got, to sit down with you for a couple of weeks. You're not joining some big long program. We're just asking you to meet with a friend here at church to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for you. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend Pastor Joel. Congratulations, guys. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.